Welcome to the Greater St. Paul BOMA and Capitol River Council Ward 2 Candidate Forum. A quick shout out to Julie Bach as she's in the back of the room. Julie, wave. She was very kind to donate the space tonight. Thank you, Julie. My name is Bill Thermos. I'm with AON. I also serve as the Greater St. Paul BOMA Board Chair, and I would like to thank everyone for attending our event this evening. Before we get started with the debate, I want to cover a few instructions for the audience. First and foremost, we want this to be a respectful forum. The candidates who are participating all deserve the opportunity to share their thoughts, so we ask that you refrain from applauding, whistling, or making any noise in response to their answers. If you want to boo or hiss at me, you can do that, but not these folks. Yeah, that's pretty good, whoever that was. It's a good little light moment to start the debate. I like that. Okay. At the end, we will encourage you all to applaud them for being here this evening. It's very challenging, and I'm sure they got some great answers for us, so it'll be fun and exciting. Part of the debate will focus on questions from the audience. If you'd like to submit a question for consideration, raise your hand now, and we'll pass you a card. This question must pertain to downtown St. Paul and is directed to all three candidates. I believe John here is handing out cards. Are you the only one handing out cards, John? Oh, Pat Wolf is handing out cards as well. So just hold your hand up, and they will get you a card. Write your question down. I don't know that we'll get to all the questions. We will select from those questions a couple for the candidates. And we'll go forward from there. So again, if you're interested in submitting a question, raise your hand. Make sure, I think we've got most of you. I'll give you a second here for these folks to get through this process. Well, that's a lot of questions. That's a great sign. Okay, at this point, I'm gonna introduce Eric Anderson with FairVote. He's just going to take a couple minutes to go over the basics of ranked choice voting. Eric, please.
Hey, folks. Hey, I'm Eric Anderson. I'm leading FairVote Minnesota's St. Paul ranked choice voting education effort around our city council election here. And as part of that, we're just hoping to really quickly go through how ranked choice voting will work in this election here. So just like if you voted for city council in 2011 or mayor in 2013 here, you'll get to rank the candidates as you like them first all the way through six, since there's six candidates running here in Ward 2. And the way the counting will work is count up all those first choices. And if someone gets over 50% of the first choices, they win and the counting's over and that's it. But if no one quite gets to 50% of those first choices, then there's a little bit more counting left to do. And the process will be that the candidate with the fewest votes gets eliminated, and anyone who voted for that candidate, now it's their second choice that counts. So you always will have one vote. It might just transfer down to your second choice or maybe even to your third or fourth. So again, we'll know on the Monday after the election, finally for sure, who's won. And I hope you can use this opportunity at the forum here to think not just about who your first choice is going to be, but also who your second, third, maybe even fourth will be. So thank you so much.
Not on my script, but for those of you with cell phones, please take a minute and silence them for us. You don't want to have that phone going off. And with that, the questions, as you're doing that, once you get them done, maybe John will pass them to this side of the aisle, and John here will collect them up. So if you've done that, please pass them this way. If you need a few more minutes, just continue to pass to the right, and we'll grab them as we go. And let's see. Now I'd like to introduce our moderator for the debate, Curtis Gilbert. Curtis is a reporter with NPR and has experienced moderating debates. So, Curtis, I will turn it over to you. Good luck, candidates. Enjoy the time, and we'll see you after the debate.
Well, welcome, everybody. I'm glad you could all be here today, and thank you to the candidates. My role in this is really just to moderate. The format of this debate is not that I made up a bunch of questions to ask you. The questions are coming from the sponsors, from the candidates themselves. The candidates each came up with questions to ask each other, and that'll be a lot of fun. And then the final round will be your questions. And so I hope you've got some, because otherwise we're going to have to ask these folks what their, you know, Secret Service code name would be or something like that. And of course, my other role will be to keep things moving along. We're not going to have strict time limits in this debate. But I would ask that you guys keep your time, you know, to a minute, two, three at the most, per answer. If you ramble on too long, I do reserve the right to respectfully ask you to wrap things up and let someone else have a chance to talk, but I'm sure that won't be necessary during this debate. So that's all I have to say at the beginning. Rather than me introducing the candidates, I thought we'd begin by just having you each introduce yourself, take about 2 minutes apiece, and we will start with Mr. Bill Hosko.
Use a microphone. Yeah.
I don't have a stand, so I'm going to put this up in front of my mouth. Yeah, my name is Bill Hosko. Met many of you. I'm a small business owner here in downtown St. Paul for going on 22 years now. And recently I opened a second business, a place for musicians to play. Many of you know that as well.
Yeah. Are these on? I'm not sure if they're on.
Okay. Yeah, now I can hear an echo. Yeah, I don't want to be too loud. My name is Bill Hosko. I'm owner of Hosko Gallery and Custom Framing here in downtown St. Paul. Going on 22 years, recently I opened a second business down here, a place for musicians to play called Music Forest Cafe. Many of you don't know this. Back when I decided to open an art gallery here in my hometown, I could have done so in Minneapolis, but you know, my heart was here. I was living up in northwest Minnesota on a farm, and I was doing a lot of my own artwork, selling it at other art galleries, but I decided to open up my own gallery here. And it had to be in downtown St. Paul. It wasn't going to be Minneapolis, it wasn't going to be in a strip mall somewhere, but it had to be in downtown St. Paul. And after all these years, there's not a single regret that I've done this. On the table out there earlier, and I'll have it with me tonight, another little fact you might not know about me is since the fall of 1980, when I was 18 years old, I started collecting articles on the development of downtown St. Paul on the riverfront. Anything ever built, thought of, or wanted that was mentioned in print since that time, I have in these books. So if you want to take a look at one of those on the way out, I'd be happy to show it to you. I just turned 53, and you know, I feel like I'm 14 inside. I love life. Every year I get older, I like it more. And the truth is, part of, I think, why I like life so much is I've met all of these really nice people in the last 21 years. And some of you I've known for many years. And I'm very happy to be here. One other thing is, many of you know I've run for office in the past. I've came in second place the last two go-rounds. Incumbent Dave Thune is retiring. So perhaps with your help, I will get in there this November 3rd. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hosko. Next, we're going to hear from Rebecca Nick.
Thank you, and I really don't know if this is on. Is it on?
It
is on, okay. Thank you so much to BOMA and to the Capital River Council for hosting tonight's forum. Really appreciate this opportunity. And thank you all so much for coming out tonight. I was actually, I have a 2-year-old and a 1-year-old, and I was zipping them into their coats this morning for the track outside. And it occurred to me that this is the time of year when, you know, it's kind of time to huddle inside your home and not necessarily venture out into the public sphere for things like this. So the fact that you all took the time to come out really means a lot. My name is Rebecca Naker, and I am hoping to earn your first choice support to represent you and Ward 2 on the St. Paul City Council. And I don't know about you, but I feel like this is an incredibly exciting time for St. Paul. I know we can't applaud candidates, but can we applaud that? This is a time when we have new businesses opening on every corner. We have our population is growing for the first time in so many years. There are new restaurants, CHS Field is booming. We have so much to be excited about. And at the same time, we know that we have substantial challenges. 30% of the children in our city live in poverty. We have some of the biggest gaps in our city, in the country, between white people and people of color in terms of achievement and in terms of employment. We have homeless people on our streets every day and every night without adequate services. We have tensions as we grow in our city between residents and between business owners, between biking and parking, between people who live downtown and people who come to visit downtown. And these are all serious challenges that we're going to have to deal with over the next few years. I'm running for this office because I come from a family and from a faith tradition that have taught me that when you see things around you that need to be improved, it's your responsibility to do what you can to make them right. And that's what I've been doing ever since I was 11 years old, and I started a club for the kids in my neighborhood called the Good Deeds Club, and we just kind of met and did our projects and marched around with posters every weekend. To when I became a public school teacher in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, ranked 49th in education in the country at the time as a state, to when I went to India to work for public education there, and now I work at Achieve Minneapolis supporting public schools in Minneapolis. So this is what I've been doing for my entire life. But I'm also running for this office not just to make policy change, but to make a cultural change. Because I've been talking to people in our city for the last 2 years, and what I hear over and over again, and we've seen evidence of it just in the last couple weeks, is that people feel left out of the process again and again. People feel like we need more transparency in how decisions are made. People need to be included, whether they live on the West Side or Summit Hill or West 7th or downtown. And people feel like we need courage to make decisions that are sometimes unpopular. They're sometimes not what the mayor would want, but they're the right thing for our neighborhood or for our city. And those values of transparency and inclusivity and courage are things that I have been living and working my entire life, my entire career, and they're values that I look forward to bringing to the City Council. So thank you, and I look forward to a great discussion tonight.
Thank you, Rebecca Nager. And finally, we'll hear from Darren Tobolt.
Hi. Thank you all for coming out tonight, and thank you to the Capitol River Council and for BOMA for putting this together. What a nice theater. My name is Darren Tobolt, and I'm really excited about the opportunity to be your city council member next year. I grew up in South St. Paul. I was the first of my family to go to college. I served in the National Guard to pay my way through the University of Minnesota. And in 1996, I moved here to St. Paul to be an organizer on the Wellstone re-election campaign that year. That experience taught me the value and the importance of progressive organizing. And I've been here in St. Paul for the last 20 years doing just that. Last year, I was invited to a meeting at the Baker Rec Center on the West Side to talk about kids getting into trouble in the out-of-school times. And we had this meeting in the parking lot of the Baker Rec Center because it was locked. And the irony was not lost on me that we're trying to figure out how to keep kids out of trouble outside a locked rec center. So I decided at that point that I needed to put my experience to work for the people of St. Paul and run for city council. So I've been doing that for the last year. I've been going around and talking to the people about three things: about making sure that the city is providing quality public services, that our rec centers and our libraries are open and providing opportunities for seniors, for kids, for families, and that we're building strong and safe neighborhoods, that we have complete streets that are safe for all users, that we have healthy businesses along economic corridors, and that we are engaging all citizens in this process, and that we're making sure that we're talking to people and listening to people and moving forward together. So that is why I would like your support for to be your first choice in this November's election. Thank you very much. I look forward to this.
Thank you, Darren Tobolt. Thank you, all three candidates. We're now going to move on to the first part of our debate. These are general questions about downtown St. Paul that come from the debate organizers, which is Building Owners and Managers Association and the Capitol River Council. You'll all get to answer each of these questions. This first one, we're going to start with Rebecca Nager. And the question is, as a newly elected member of the St. Paul City Council, what is your highest priority for driving growth in downtown and increasing the overall vitality of the area? Rebecca Nager.
Thank you. So those of us who live in downtown or who visit downtown know that there's Rice Park, which is very lively. There's Mears Park and Lower Town, which are booming and exciting and vibrant. And then there's that area in between, right? The ghost town, the dead zone, the frozen zone is what I've heard it called. I actually was speaking to David Miller when he was still the general manager at the St. Paul Hotel. He told me that he advises his guests to drive from the hotel to Mears Park because there's just nothing to see on the way. There's no point in walking. To me, if the heart of your downtown is called the dead zone or the ghost town or the frozen zone, that doesn't reflect very well on you as a city. And so my highest priority would be to enliven that zone in between Rice and Mears so that we have a contiguously exciting and alive downtown. So there are a couple ways I would do this. First of all, I think there's nothing like street-level retail to make it feel like things are happening. And that doesn't just provide opportunities for commercial endeavor, for getting more revenue for the city, for expanding our tax base, but it also makes people feel safer as they're walking along and their eyes on the street, which right now you walk along those corridors of kind of blank buildings and sometimes you feel a little bit unsafe. So I would make it easier for businesses to open and expand. I have a couple of ideas about how to do that. one of which is just a concierge system in City Hall. So instead of a business owner having to go through 10 or 12 different departments to get the permits that they need to open, they go to one person in City Hall who helps them bring those departments together and sort of fast track the applications of businesses that we want to see in our city. I also want to make sure that along that corridor between Rice and Mears, we have opportunities for people who are of all ages. We talk about 880 Vitality a lot. Right now in downtown, if you have small children, and I've talked to lots of people who do, there's not a lot for them to do after school. There aren't a lot of parks for them to hang out in. There aren't a lot of rec centers downtown or any. And if you're 80 years old, there isn't a lot for you to do either. So I want to make sure that the kinds of things that we're putting in cater to people at all age ranges. I'm really in support of the 4th Street Greenway. I think this is an exciting idea to take cars off of 4th Street. It's already limited to one lane anyway. And to make that a bikeway, to get people walking from one side of downtown to the other, I think that's going to help encourage that retail there as well. And then finally, I'm really excited about coming up with a way to do a downtown ambassador corps in St. Paul. I don't like taking ideas from our western suburb across the river, but I do think that if you walked around downtown Minneapolis and you see the Downtown Improvement District Corps wearing those vests, sweeping up trash, helping guide people from place to place, doing wayfinding, having walkie-talkies with them so it feels like there's more of an authoritative presence around if you needed help, I'd really be excited about bringing something like that to also help in that corridor between Rice and Mears.
Thank you, Rebecca Naker. Next, we're going to hear from Darren Tobolt. Mr. Tobolt, same question. As a newly elected member of the St. Paul City Council, what's your highest priority for driving growth downtown and increasing the overall vitality of the area?
My highest priority is to engage downtown as a neighborhood. There's thousands of people living downtown, thousands of new people living downtown. And we need to realize that and embrace that this is a place that people live, work, and play. So we need to build connections, both physical and personal. The pedestrian connections, the skyways, the sidewalks, transit, bike, and wayfinding. We need to make sure that we're building those, building between Mears Park, Rice Park, as well as Pedro Park, and then all the way around St. Paul as well. There's a lot of downtown. There's multiple neighborhoods within downtown, and we need to get in between them. We need to encourage more investment, and as a city council member, I would encourage more investment from our building owners what was referred to as the dead zone, to create warm and public spaces for community and commerce. We can't ignore public safety. We have to look at that as well, and I think that more investment will bring that. We need to encourage small business development, the diverse retail, entertainment, and dining options that people move downtown to find. We need to do that, not just for our residents, but for the workers and the general overall vitality of downtown. Don't forget access to the river. We are one of the great things that sets St. Paul apart from other cities is the beautiful Mississippi River that St. Paul is on, and we need to embrace that. And the Great River Master Planning process that's gone on, I'm sure many of you were a part of it, I was too. We need to keep that in mind as we design forward. We need to move ahead with things that I have been working on, like I said earlier, Pedro Park. We were successful this year in getting the police finally out of that building. And in the future years, we need to get that building down and really have a nice, beautiful green space there. And I'd love to make sure that the district council downtown is representative of the residents. It's great that the district council has the many interests in downtown, but it is the only place where people who live downtown have a strong voice. And I want to make sure that their voice is really represented in that district council.
Thank you, Mr. Tobolt. Finally, Bill Hosko, I'll just repeat the question so people know what you're responding to. What is your highest priority for driving growth in downtown and increasing the overall vitality of the area?
Well, like my counterparts, there's not just one thing. There's a number of things. You know, when I opened my art gallery, I was probably number 200 as far as retail business. I was probably in 200th place. At this point in time, I'm probably 8th in place, only surpassed by Candyland and Walgreens and a couple of other places. So I've survived and seen a lot. My number one thing, and a lot of you perhaps know this, is over the years when citizen input has been asked for on project after project after project, in the end, people weren't really listened to. And that will be the first thing that'll change if I get elected. The other thing is, these are all small, but they're important things. When you contact my office, your call will be taken and or it will be returned. You know, the ballpark, the New Saints ballpark, I mean, I was really on the city council and the mayor to allow the public to have input on that. Ultimately, the ballpark design and construction committee was created, and at the same time, a city hall blog was created. The ballpark committee, some of you were participating, it could not have been, it could have been better, obviously. The city hall blog, unless it's changed, it allows you to post one comment, but not more than one, so there's really not a dialogue amongst people. That needs to change, because then you can help educate each other on what's going on. There's multiple things going on downtown, as Rebecca and Darren had just mentioned. The bike loop, for instance, that's been talked about. There was a lot of misinformation going around out there. I bike year-round, as you know. I rallied a lot of business people and residents together to say, you know, we like biking, but we don't want to lose 147 parking meters down here. The 6th Street sidewalk widening, that entailed at the time moving a bus stop in front of River Park Loft condominiums. I led an effort where we had a public meeting about it, residents showed up, and, you know, ultimately things changed as far as that bus stop being moved. Annually, the mayor gives a state of the city address, and we always hear about what we've gained, but we often don't hear about what we've lost, and we really can't keep track of where we're going unless we talk about the profit and loss on an annual basis. That's something that I would encourage. The current opportunities that are really out there is the reuse of Macy's. It's very exciting. Walgreens is going in there. That's great. The sad part of it is we've taken Walgreens from a private property owner, so he's lost his anchor tenant. The practice rink for the Minnesota Wild is exciting. A couple restaurants, a brew pub. But a lot of people are saying, what else? Is this it? And I think Rebecca mentioned it earlier. What goes in there needs to be multi-generational and multi-use. There needs to be something in there for everybody, a place they can go, because Macy's was kind of an anchor destination, and we lost that when they closed. Union Depot, I think there was a report not long ago, it's losing $6 million a year. We need to find a way to actually make that thing generate revenue and be a daily, weekly, year-round attraction. I have some concepts for that. I'm not going to take up your time tonight, perhaps maybe later. That's a hole that needs to be filled. Talk about 4th Street Greenway. I'm not in favor at this time of removing traffic on 4th Street. I'm sorry, folks, the thing was just rebuilt. I mean, and now we're going to spend millions of dollars digging it all up. 4th Street could be made beautiful as is, with a lot of green space. And if any of you have ever been to Sioux Falls, South Dakota, they have a beautiful art walk. And with 4th Street largely as is, we could install an art walk that would actually bring people from lower town to upper town. 5th Street and 6th Street, they're the other
two.
I can talk
finish
about
your thought.
Okay. 5th Street and 6th Street, they should be greenways, landscaping to pull people down. And 7th Street should be like the street of lights from East 7th down near the new Dark Horse restaurant all the way up to the West 7th area. So there's a lot of possibilities. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hoska. Okay, this is question number two from the predetermined questions from the organizers. This, Mr. Tobolt, you'll be answering first on this one. Please discuss your view of transit and transportation and tell us what you think, whether you think downtown parking should be expanded or contracted, assuming that downtown continues to grow. Darren Tobolt?
I think we can assume that downtown's going to continue to grow. A healthy transportation system is important for all of us. It's important to our public health, it's important to the life of our city and its vitality, and it's important to our planet. So I've worked for 20 years to build out that system here in St. Paul for more sidewalk coverage, for more skyway access, for better transit possibilities and transit access, as well as safe bike routes. Those things I believe in, those are things I've worked on for a long time, and those are things I'm going to work on as a city council member. I want to work hard to expand that system. We need to have, and we're looking forward to having better transit options in the Riverview corridor going down West 7th, as well as hopefully a streetcar on Robert Street that will go over to the West Side Flats. These sort of connections are going to build a stronger downtown and for all of us. Cars are also part of that downtown. It's a major transportation choice, and adequate parking is absolutely necessary for downtown. You know, the recent downtown parking study is a crucial first step in building those relationships and starting that conversation between residents, workers, employers, building owners, and everyone working together to find the solutions for parking as we move forward. And those things that we need are better technology, wayfinding, and better pedestrian corridors with vital businesses along those corridors. They all play a role in the future of downtown in better transit options and better parking options.
Thank you, Mr. Tobolt. Mr. Hosko, same question to you. What's your view of transit and transportation? And tell us whether you think that downtown parking should be expanded or contracted as the downtown continues to grow.
Well, if you want a transit leader, I'm it. I've been riding that bus for 21 years. I'm a year-round bicyclist. So I walk the walk and ride the ride and pedal the pedal, I guess you might say. The immediate thing that needs to be addressed and has been put off for many years is for anybody who rides the bus on a regular basis, there's a lot of poor behavior on the bus. You know, there's loud behavior, profanity at times. And frankly, kids grow up in this environment. A good society does not allow this to continue. I remember somebody at Metro Transit told me a number of years ago, there's no political will to help them address this, and I will help address it. Transit going down West 7th Street. There's an option to talk about streetcars, rapid bus, and perhaps light rail. I looked at all the above objectively. Streetcars, with all due respect, they don't really make a lot of economic sense. One, it cannot eliminate an existing bus route. Most of the buses that run that corridor, the 54, the 74, the 63, and there's one going up St. Clair, they're largely underutilized as is. The thing that is kind of exciting, I think, is the potential of light rail in the future, leaving the backside of Union Depot, following a right of way along Shepherd Road, with a stop at the West Publishing site when it's rebuilt someday, bottom of Chestnut Hill, which is, serves the upper landing, the riverfront, and all that activity up near the XL and Cassettas and all of that. And then past the High Bridge, it would cross over and utilize the Ford Plant Railroad spur, which stops at the Ford Plant. So there could be a stop at Schmidt, all the new housing up at Otto, the rebuilt Sibley Plaza, and then the last stop would be up at the Ford Plant site, and then ultimately crossing the river and hooking up with the Blue Line. That's very exciting. Many of you don't know that the Ford Plant was St. Paul's largest private taxable property. And I would argue if there will be, in the future at least, a light rail to that stop, the value of that property would really escalate a lot. As far as parking downtown, in the future, when residential is added, there will almost always certainly be parking as part of that underneath the building. You know, our commercial sector still is contracting. It's really not growing. So it seems like for many years to come, there is enough commercial parking. Parking meters is something that's been on a lot of people's minds. I was at the Linwood Rec Center last night. People are really hot under the collar about that. Parking meters downtown, I do not support the extension of parking meters, primarily because this market down here is becoming much more residential than commercial, so it would impact residents a lot. And then biking, the bike loop downtown. There's a way of putting in a bike loop of sorts that makes biking a lot more user-friendly down here. That also retains the on-street parking. That's important. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hosko. Rebecca Naker, what's your view of transit and transportation, and should parking be expanded or contracted as downtown grows?
The Green Line is a great start, but all of us who take transit know that it's not nearly enough. If the people who make decisions about transit every day were dependent on transit, I think we'd see things looking a lot different. We'd see buses, thank you. We'd see buses coming every 10 minutes, not every 55 minutes, as I was stranded downtown a couple months ago, luckily without my children, waiting for one. We'd see heated bus shelters and shelters that are actually shelters, not just a sign or, if you're lucky, a bench. We'd probably see Wi-Fi on buses. And all of these things, I think, are necessary in order to make transit not an option of last resort. It has to be a first choice for people who have choices, not the last possible thing you can do if you have no other choice. That's really important to me, and that is an equity issue in my opinion. We also have to talk about other forms of transportation. It has to be safe and easy and accessible for you to get around downtown and all over the city, whether you're pushing a stroller, in a wheelchair, with a cane, on a bike, or on your 2 feet. That's how you make your city truly accessible through all methods of transportation for everyone who lives here. Now, when it comes to parking, I actually don't know if we have enough of it downtown. The parking management study said that at peak capacity, we're at about 73% of our parking spaces full. Unfortunately, that study didn't take into account monthly contract parking. So they counted as empty spaces, spaces and ramps that were empty, but they were actually monthly contract spaces, which any of you who have ever done a roundabout and a parking ramp know that that's pretty frustrating to find that those are the only ones that are left. And when it really comes to parking, I was talking to my husband last night and saying, the search for parking is kind of like the search for extraterrestrial intelligence in the universe. Wait a second, I'll explain. It's not about whether or not it exists as much as it is about whether or not you can find it, right? And right now, I've tried parking tonight, it's not easy to find. And I think that's ultimately what it's about. Now, does that mean that we need to create more parking? I would say no, not right now, because I don't think creating a vibrant, exciting downtown, I don't think that exciting downtown, I'm 31 years old, I'm a millennial, when I think about moving to an exciting city, it's not one that's full of parking ramps, frankly. I don't know about anybody else in the audience, but that's probably not what brought you downtown. So I think instead of building additional parking right now, what we need to do is a few things. First, I would give light rail another year, because we know that when new technology comes along, people don't automatically change their old habits and adapt. So we might see some changes in terms of people taking transit if we give light rail another year. I also think that if we give parking meters downtown time, I frankly disagree with Bill on this. I think that we have been not valuing our downtown parking enough. I think St. Paul is growing up, we're a big city, we have a lot to offer, and we need to value that at what it's worth. And I think downtown parking in the evening is worth a lot these days, especially when people park in our downtown and use it as a park and ride to take light rail and go to a Twins game. So I'm excited to see what happens as parking meters come online and as we hopefully balance out the cost of on-street and off-street parking. I think better signage is essential. You drive around downtown, even if you live here, you don't know where to find a parking ramp and you don't know what the charge is until you're already halfway through the bar and you don't know if there's any parking left in there. And then I would also work with ramp owners to see if some of those extra monthly contract parking spaces can actually be converted into perhaps short-term parking, so that when you're running into the Dunn Brothers on Wabasha, the Victory Ramp has a 5-minute spot for you right there that you can pull into and pay a dollar for example. I'm sorry, last thing. This is very exciting for me. And finally, if there are still problems, I would then do the parking study again, and this time take into account monthly contract spaces, and then see if we still have a need. Thank you.
You're welcome. All right, we're moving on now to part two of the debate. And part two is questions for the candidates from the candidates. This gets a little complicated. It's kind of like ranked choice voting or something like that. So each candidate was asked to come up with a question for one of the both of the other two candidates. And so we're going to take turns. And the way it's going to work, we're going to start with Ms. Naker. Rebecca Naker is going to ask a question of Darren Tobolt, okay? And then after Mr. Tobolt answers, Ms. Naker will have an opportunity for follow-up. Mr. Tobolt will get to answer, and then he'll have the last word. Until then, he gets to ask a question of her and so forth. So anyway, I'll make sure that we're being fair to everybody here as we go through this. Ms. Naker, what is your question for Darren Tobolt?
I think if we can survive this debate, we'll be able to do anything. I'll understand the rules. So Darren, my question for you is, you seem to me to be very much a member of the establishment, the political establishment. So, you know, you've worked in government for your whole career. You've gotten the support of the mayor and of Councilmember Thune. Your campaign has been seeking and getting endorsements from lots of elected leaders. And yet I think that over the next few years, we're going to need to make decisions that might maybe be different from what the mayor would want. We're gonna need independent thinking. And so my question for you is there a specific policy that you could talk about, maybe related to the city as a whole, maybe related to downtown, that you would support, but that you think maybe the political establishment or the mayor might not support?
Well, I think we were at one last night. I guess we forgot Aaron Murphy and Mayor Brock too, right?
Those are the elected officials.
So, we were last night when we were at Grand Avenue talking about parking meters, and I differ very strongly from what the what the mayor is proposing there, and his lack of public process in installing meters along Grand Avenue. And I think that we need, for my entire career, yes, I work for an elected official. I work for Victoria Reinhardt, for lay that out there. But for my entire career, I've been working in communities and working with organizing and making sure that we're, you know, representing people. So I am a great believer in public process, and I differ with the mayor on that.
Ms. Nacker, follow up, if you'd like.
I guess I'm just wondering if there's anything maybe specific to downtown that you could talk about, just given the audience.
Oh, yes. You know, I'm concerned about the level of tax increment financing that we have downtown. The mayor has done very good job of getting a lot of development happening downtown. I'm concerned that we're not seeing the benefits of that throughout the neighborhoods in St. Paul because of the amount of that's caught up in tax increment financing and rolled over tax increment financing that should be retired, and then it ends up not being retired. I'm an advocate for moving back of that, or having a much more honest tax policy.
Okay, and Mr. Tobolt, now don't put your microphone down because it's your turn to ask a question of Mr. Hosko.
Hey, Bill.
So at the last at the last forum we had, you talked about safety in the skyways, and I know that you're a business owner downtown, and I'm interested in hearing your thoughts about what we can do for public safety downtown and in the skyways and on the streets.
You know, when you've been down here for 21 years, you've seen a lot. I mean, shootings and all sorts of things. I don't know. Safety, skyways. Truth is, a lot of people come downtown evenings and weekends. They don't feel safe on the skyways because there's so little activity. Most of the stores are closed up. And one suggestion that I do have is almost every building there are cameras monitoring. In many of the buildings there is a guard on site. Some there aren't, of course. I think there should be an audio system attached to those cameras, so when a guard notices some activity that perhaps should not be occurring, and there is a thing out there called the Skyway Rules of Conduct, and a lot of people don't know that, but you know, the Skyway is a public right-of-way, but you are supposed to have a destination in mind when you're going through the Skyway. So what I'm proposing is that, you know, like in my building, let's say somebody decides to lay down on the floor and take a nap around the corner from where my gallery is, a guard would see that. They could say, you know, Mister, please get up, you know, and get to your destination. It's a way of allowing people who are perhaps misbehaving to know they're being watched, and there's no confrontation between staff and the people who are perhaps doing things they shouldn't. If people knew that was going on, I think it would make the skyway seem a lot safer. And one other thing that I think needs to happen is for the Central Light Corps light rail station stop. A stair tower was put in there. There's been, you know, some misbehavior associated with that. There needs to be on that site, right next to the stair tower, there's a little triangle of land. Most of you perhaps know of it. The Metropolitan Council owns that land, I believe. They need to put in a security station there, a waiting room, and somebody shaking their head. No, I'm sorry. Okay. There needs to be a security station there, a waiting room, and public restrooms. It'd make a world of difference for people taking that train down here because it's a long ride over here from Minneapolis. And there are Metro Transit officers monitoring that corner, as most of you know, daily, year round. That's a huge expense. If there was a building there and a building for that people felt safe, they could wait for the train, wait for nearby buses, that would make safety. People would feel a lot safer if they were down in that area. So those are two things, Darren.
Thank you, Mr. Hosko. And Mr. Tobolt, you can ask a follow-up if you want.
Thanks. Yeah, so the audio to allow talkback and the central station improvements, those sound really great. I'd like to see, you know, maybe other, you know, other tools in our toolbox of how we address public safety. You know, like the, I think BOMA has the, what do they call it, the Youth Ambassador Program. Where they provide opportunities for youth. They that they see in the skyways and in the transit stops. Do you know about that, Bill, or what do you think about, you know, sort of programs like that that provide mentorship opportunities as well?
I'm not familiar with that program. I can't know everything that's going on. But the two things that I mentioned are achievable and in short order. And there is a safety issue with the light rail, and there is a safety issue on the skyways. Whether it's real or perceived, even perceived is real to many people. So,
okay. Thank you.
All right, Mr. Husko, it's your turn to ask a question. Now you get to turn the tables on Darren Tobel. Yes.
Yeah, I thought the same
That's
thing.
That.
I wasn't going to ask.
It'll all work out, I promise. I did the math.
I wasn't going to ask a question. I didn't know what to ask, frankly, ladies and gentlemen. But Darren, where were you born, and then when did you move to St. Paul? There's a softball.
Come on, that question.
That's the ultimate softball, yeah. No, so I was born at Divine Redeemer Hospital in Sault Ste. Paul, which doesn't exist anymore. I just recently found out. I grew up there. I graduated from high school, and I moved to St. Paul in 1996, I think I said in my intro, to work for Senator Wellstone's campaign.
Okay.
Been here ever since.
No follow-up.
Okay. Yeah, it's a pretty simple question. Not a lot of gotcha there. Now, Darren Tobel, your turn to ask a question of Rebecca Naker.
Rebecca, you've said how you want to work more closely in conjunction with the school board and how we can provide opportunities. How do you see this fitting into downtown with the businesses, residents, and how would it relate here?
Sure. Well, as I mentioned earlier, I think that we need to be thinking about downtown not just as a place for people to come and go to Amsterdam or go to CHS Field, but also a place where people are living and raising children. And I've actually talked to lots of people as I've been knocking on doors who are really interested in the schools that are downtown and the options that they're going to have. Also, the schools right across the river on the west side. And as you know, I've been doing a lot of work to support and improve our west side schools. In fact, I actually just came tonight from a very exciting community event that I was part of planning called Westside Wednesdays, which is bringing the entire community into Humboldt High School to support the school, to see what it's like. Hopefully some downtown parents came and brought their maybe 5 or 6 year old and thought, oh, maybe this is some place that I could see myself sending my child to in the future. In terms of the bigger aspects of your question though, Darren, I mean, I think that one of the reasons why I'm running for this seat, I was a public school teacher. I've worked for my whole life supporting kids in my job and also as a mentor and a tutor. And to me, there's so much more that the city can do to support kids beyond just the 7 hours a day that they're in school. So whether our parks and rec centers and libraries are open when kids are actually going to use them, whether or not the person who's staffing that library or that rec center knows the curriculum that that student in that grade is doing at that time and can support them with meaningful enrichment activities, all of those things are things that the city and the school board can work together on. As an example of a complete lack of coordination, I was recently talking to somebody who said that he has spent the last 10 years trying to get the school board and the city to agree that every student in St. Paul Public Schools should have a library card. This was contentious, and he just succeeded after 10 years. So that's an example of how I wouldn't want to do things.
Mr. Tumble, you get a follow-up.
Oh, well, I was hoping for more of a softball. I was hoping we could bond over the fact that we need to have more options downtown. I mean, the young families, I know that we're both seeing them. Downtown, the strollers, more opportunities maybe for a rec center and also for a grade school in downtown. What do you think about that?
I think it's a great idea. I talked earlier about the need for more rec centers, and I think the Y is actually interested in expanding, so I'm looking forward to hopefully getting to talk to them about how to make that happen. We also do have great schools already downtown. Creative Arts is really exciting, and if you're ever at the Starbucks or the Dunn Brothers, you'll see the students there right before school getting ready. So. But I think there's always room for additional school options.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Ms. Naker, you now get to ask a question of Bill Husko.
So, Bill, my question for you is sort of the opposite of my question for Darren, actually. It seems to me, from what I know of your work, that in many of the groups that you've been part of and in many of the work, that the different kinds of projects you've done, you've been seen as sort of a maverick. And sometimes even as someone who has created a bit of dissension and in some of the groups that you've been part of, including the Capitol River Council. And so I'm wondering, as if you were to take office as the next city council member, are there certain relationships with groups that you think you need to repair in order to build consensus, and how would you go about doing that?
No.
I'm going to find a quarter in my pocket. You know, I'm running for this job, folks, because I have a full life. I love what I do. I love this new business. I like getting up everything in the morning, you know, every day. 21 years I've been down here, and my single thing is that you see this quarter, and I brought this up at the last candidate forum. City Hall has a habit of showing you this quarter, this side of it, and they often don't show you the other side. That's all I've ever wanted to do for 21 years is make sure you get full, accurate information so that collectively we make decisions together. And I have trust that the people of this ward and the city will always back the right idea, always.
Careful.
I guess maybe I'm just wondering if you can talk a little bit about some of the partnerships that you think you might need to build, history aside, in order to make progress for the ward.
Well, when I was a board member on the Capitol River Council for 3 years, one of the initiatives I had is that we allow the videotaping of the meetings. The CRC meetings, as all district council meetings are, they're largely publicly funded. I introduced a motion that basically replicated the Highland District Council's policy on videotaping, and it was passed by the board. And then the executive committee, in a closed door session, overruled that motion, brought it back to the board, and it was voted down. You know, this is your district council, ladies and gentlemen. If you can't make it to the meetings, you should have a right to see what goes on from the comfort of your home or office. That's one example. I can give more.
Mr. Hosko, would you like to ask a question of Rebecca Naker?
I don't think I'm going to get a softball.
Nah, same one with this with Darren. Where were you born and when did you move to St. Paul?
I was born in Brigham and Women's Hospital in Boston, Massachusetts. And I moved to the Twin Cities when I was 6, and I moved to St. Paul in 2011. Lived in Macro for about 6 months and then saw the bright side and moved to Ward 2 on the west side. 6 months later.
Any follow up?
The West Side was my childhood home, so she made a good decision.
Agreed.
All right, well, that concludes the questions from the candidates, and now it's time for the questions from you, the audience. These have been handed up to me on note cards. Just looking at them here, there's way more questions than we're going to have time for, unless it's the serious lightning round. But we'll get through just as many as we possibly can. And we'll take turns starting. Mr. Tobel, you go first on this one. Given the nationally publicized event between Chris Lawley and the St. Paul Police in the downtown Skyway, what do you envision can be done to improve the relationship between the St. Paul Police Department and the Black community?
You know, this is a national conversation that's been going on. And St. Paul needs to be on the forefront of this conversation. The current civilian review process that okayed that was developed 20 years ago between the St. Paul Police, the city, and the NAACP. The NAACP has since said that they would like to revisit how the civilian review process is done and who makes up the board. I think that we should do that. I think we need to do that. And as a city council member, I would make sure that we do that.
Mr. Hosko, thoughts on the Chris Lawley Skyway incident or just generally improving relations between the Black community and the police?
I'm really sorry that incident happened. I go through the First National Bank. That's where that occurred, right? And I know the guards there, and the guards aren't racist. I mean, there's actually multi-ethnicities that are guards at that desk. So I'm sorry that situation happened. Perhaps what I mentioned earlier, if there'd been an audio versus a face-to-face with the gentleman, maybe things might have been different. You know, I'm gonna, this city, we've had Black police chiefs. I mean, we have a lot of people of color throughout City Hall. And I think on a race level, I mean, this city, the people who work for this city, I don't believe they're racist. I don't believe they're homophobic. I believe they care about the citizens. I think they take their jobs seriously and responsibly, by and large. That's my reply.
Ms. Naker, thoughts on Chris Lawley, St. Paul Police and the Black community?
It's really shameful to me that waiting while Black is a term that's come to define the situation in our city. And given the gaps that I talked about earlier, the employment gap, the opportunity gap between white people and people of color, unfortunately, this is just one more of those gaps in treatment. And it may not be, and I don't think it is intentional, but we do see the prevalence of these kinds of racist attitudes and behaviors. I think there are a couple of things that can make a difference with this, and many of these things are ideas that the St. Paul Police are very much in favor of themselves. One of those is community policing. It makes a big difference, and many people in this audience maybe grew up in this scenario where you actually knew the police officer who was coming down the street on the beat. That's very different than somebody driving by in a patrol car, coming by even on a horse or on a motorcycle. So I would be very much in favor of making sure we have enough cops to walk the beat and to get to know people who live in the community. I also think cultural competency training for officers is key, and body cameras would really have helped us understand what happened in that situation better. We were looking at a very fuzzy security camera. I don't know how I feel about cameras in general, but I feel like the security camera certainly doesn't do a good enough job showing you what happened. A body camera would have. And the officers that I've talked to are very much in favor of body cameras because most officers, most of the time, are doing the right thing. And they also want to be held accountable when members of their corps are not doing the right thing.
All right, here's another question from the audience. This one is also about police issues downtown. It says, it seems like there's more crime downtown recently. What do you plan to do to address downtown crime? I guess we talked about Skyway a little bit earlier, but this is broader.
Is this back to me again?
Oh, I'm sorry, yes. No, actually, it's Mr. Hosko. I'm sorry, Mr. Hosko. That's right, yeah, that's my job, thank you.
Well, you know, by and large, downtown St. Paul is very safe. There's a perception that it's not safe, and I guess it goes back to conduct on the Skyways. What I suggested earlier would make a big difference. That central corridor stop that I talked about earlier, that would make a big difference. And also the other component is appearances matter. And part of, you know, if you didn't get my flyer before you came in for the campaign, please get one on the way out. The city's really good about creating things and then can be rather poor about maintaining things. And some areas of downtown are quite beautiful and some areas are rather neglected. People come down here and they see the neglect, and neglect can oftentimes attract crime. And so those are the three things: the Skyway, the suggestion that I brought earlier, that central corridor stop, there needs to be a security center there, and there needs to be better maintenance down here. This place needs to look professional, look well cared for, and people who are causing trouble, they're not doing it in front of the St. Paul Hotel. They're not doing it in front of a public kitchen. They're doing it in the places that, you know, could be a lot more attractive than they are.
Ms. Naker, downtown crime.
Right after there was the great spike in crime, as it was reported by the media in the Skyways this last summer, I actually contacted the local patrol, the downtown patrol, to see if I could do a walk along with them in the Skyways and sort of see for myself what was going on. And I learned a couple of things on that trip. One is that if the cops ever offer to take you around on a Segway, say no. A lot harder than it looks. And I also learned that actually, first of all, it was pretty quiet in the Skyways. I think that sometimes the perception of crime is really exaggerated. And I was really impressed by the professionalism of the law enforcement officers I was walking with and their relationships with the building security officers, which I think is really important, so that the building security officers know exactly what to do if there ever is a situation. I think there are two specific things that would help with downtown public safety. One of those is the Downtown Improvement District and the ambassadors that I talked about earlier. Again, I think if there are more people walking around, more people wearing vests, more people with walkie-talkies, you just inherently feel safer. You feel like there's someone around to help if you needed it. And then also the retail that I talked about earlier, the eyes on the street. The fact of the matter is that when people are outside shopping, having a good time, walking along 4th Street or wherever it happens to be, that's what makes other people want to come out, and that just leads to a virtuous cycle of safety and of enjoying time outside downtown.
Thank you, Ms. Naker. Mr. Tobolt, downtown crime?
I agree with that, that the vibrancy downtown, bringing more vibrancy is definitely one of the things that we need to do to give downtown a feeling of safety and feel it's more safe when there's more people around, eyes on the street. The other thing, agree with the with Bill about technology improvements and making sure that our Skyway cameras are better and that they communicate between buildings and the police officers and that there's those open lines of communication. But then also, like I said, when Bill and I were talking, you know, the more tools in the toolbox, and I think it's important that we provide opportunities. And again, the work that BOMA and the police and the YWCA are doing with the Youth Ambassadors Program and approaching people that are loitering and giving them opportunities for doing better things, giving them opportunities for good instead of opportunities for not good. Those are things that we need to keep doing. Those are things we need to ramp up and do more of. And that'll give us more safety here downtown St. Paul. Thanks.
Thanks a lot. Okay, question number three. This one's going to start with Rebecca Naker. What will you do to encourage development of retail downtown? We heard people talking about retail. What would you do to make it happen?
So I already talked about one idea for this, which is the business concierge system. And just to give a little more background on that, I sit on the St. Paul Planning Commission. I've been there for the last 4 years. And that's given me a lot of experience that's actually pretty similar to what I'll hopefully experience on the City Council, making a lot of decisions that end up getting forwarded to the Council to approve or reject. And one of the things I've seen on the Planning Commission is how difficult it is for business owners to make it through the labyrinth of City Hall. I've talked to business owners downtown, one, for example, who's trying to open a bar right above the old Magic Shop on East 7th Street, whose roof sat open for 5 weeks, just rafters for 5 weeks, while he waited to get historic preservation approval to put in a roof. And again, these are people who are trying to do business in our city, trying to invest, trying to enliven downtown, sometimes even doing specific things that we call for in our small area plans that we say we want, and then they're given, it's just a complicated bureaucratic process to get it done. So I think having someone at City Hall that can help fast track those applications would really be helpful. Another option that we have is something called the Business Technical Assistance Program, BTAP. It's a model, again, from Minneapolis, but it's been nationally recognized to help small business owners open their doors. We have a lot of programs in St. Paul right now that help Securians and Travelers and Ecolabs open up, but not quite as much that's gonna, those aren't the storefronts that are going to enliven 5th or 6th Street, right? We need the small grocery stores, we need the Candylands, we need the Riverview Markets, and those business owners could particularly benefit from something like BTAP. So that's also something I would like to introduce.
Thank you very much. Mr. Tobolt, encourage more retail downtown?
I would like to reform the Planning, Economic Development, Department of Safety Inspection as well, to have more of a customer service model because, again, those people that are coming through, they want to provide jobs downtown, they want to provide vitality on the streets, they want to do all these great things, and it's only good for St. Paul to help them through this process to make sure that actually happens. So I want to make sure that we do that. Specifically, you know, I've done that from the outside. I've helped some friends of mine start their business on West 7th Street, Skylark Dry Cleaning. If you have any dry cleaning, they will pick it up and deliver. And it's a little bit of it is a labyrinth process to go through this. I've also talked to some other friends of mine that had opened Wabasha Brewing on the west side.
Thank you.
Another fantastic business. But they also said how much harder it was to open in St. Paul than experiences an opening in that other city that we don't talk about. So we definitely need to make sure that we're changing our process and being more welcoming and helping people help us.
Thank you very much, Mr. Tobolt. Bill Hosko, downtown retail?
Well, as I mentioned earlier, I'm a retailer for many years. I just went through the whole process with the city for Music Forest Cafe, and frankly, it wasn't that bad. I mean, I'd give it an 8 out of a 10, maybe even a 9 out of a 10. I think the key is when you want to open a business downtown, don't get ahead of the process. I like to ask questions, and I've told these folks, I deal with various entities and bring in, you know, hire a plumber and a contractor. I had to bring in an architect because I can do drawings, but, you know, we were above 1,000 square feet, so they felt really bad that I had to hire an architect. And and he actually liked my drawings. There wasn't much he had to change, but the process of opening a business down here, I don't think it's that onerous. Again, don't get ahead of city staff. I mean, you have to get permits, and there's inspections, and ask questions. Earlier I mentioned the importance of maintaining, is as important as creating. And what is it we're trying to attract? Okay, there's, you know, as I mentioned earlier, there's a number of blocks down here that are not very appealing. And I don't know how many of you would want to open a retail store on some of those spots, but you know, I just opened a retail store in an underutilized corner of a city parking ramp. And I put planters out front. I made it quite attractive, if I say so myself. Retail opportunities here, Macy's, I told you earlier, it's so critical. They do a right mix and they truly create a destination attraction there. I've seen a lot of plans over the years and they start out well and then they kind of fade away. So the reuse of Macy's is critical, and I believe I'm the best qualified to be in office when that is fulfilled. The Palace Theater is being renovated. I've repeatedly encouraged Joe Spencer to make sure movies go in there. The man is avoiding the subject, and it just dumbfounds me because the people down here, the people who visit down here, movies would rank high on their list of one thing they would like to see. And he's opposing it. And I sent him an email a couple days ago. You're negotiating the management contract. He said, I can't see it until they're done negotiating. I said, are you negotiating that movies can be part of the mix? Independent arts types of films. He's not replying. That's not acceptable. He works for you, ladies and gentlemen. And then Walgreens, Walgreens is being robbed, as I mentioned earlier, from a private property owner, Mr. Geller. I don't know if he has replacement. Walgreens can be bigger, better, it's great, Skyway connected. What can we do with the Walgreens space? Maybe we get a CVS in there and have a little competition for Walgreens, or maybe a dollar store. Both those things I'll look into. We can't just let that space sit empty.
Thank you, Mr. Hosko. Okay, so the word Minneapolis has been uttered here. This is a hot topic over there right now. City Council is taking up the issue of basically guaranteeing sick time for people who work within the city. And so this person wants to know whether you'll support that. And I'm going to add also requiring, should the city get involved with work schedules and making employees get their schedules a certain amount of time ahead of time? Where do you guys stand on these issues? And we will begin with Mr. Tobolt.
Yes.
Yes to what?
Both? Yes. We need to, the power of the city to be a positive force in people's lives that live here is important. And it's one of the reasons, it's the reason that I'm running for city council. And I definitely look forward to advancing the rights of working people.
Mr. Hosko, earned sick and safe time, as they call it, and also scheduling. Should the city government get involved with the schedules of people who work here?
You know, St. Paul is already perceived as being so anti-business. I mean, there's just this perception out there, and Minneapolis' economy is just exploding, and Bloomington's and all around us. And, you know, we gain something, we lose something. Overall, the progress is positive. I'll be honest with you, I'm not sure if the city should be dictating whether companies, small, large, but particularly small, should give more benefits than they're already giving the workforce that they have. I really am not comfortable saying in front of you tonight that the city should dictate what the benefit packages are between the businesses in the city and their workforce.
Ms. Nicker, what do you think?
I think the government has a moral right and a moral responsibility to get involved when things like earned sick and safe time are being discussed. I was talking to a daycare provider shortly after Thanksgiving. She works full-time taking care of other people's children, and I asked her how her Thanksgiving was, and she said she had to leave her own family right after dinner to go work at Walmart, where she also works every weekend, starting at 4 a.m. in the pharmacy, just to make enough to make ends meet for her own family. So she takes care of other people's children all day, every day, and then works at 4 a.m. at Walmart every weekend, including on Thanksgiving. These sorts of practices are not good for business because they're not good for people. Businesses also need customers who are healthy, who are safe, and who are able to patronize them. I've been in favor of earned sick and safe time from the very beginning. In my DFL convention speech, I talked about it. Equity and an opportunity for people is truly something I have done for my entire life.
Thank you very much. Okay, we are on to question number 5. We're getting through quite a few of these. So this one, Mr. Hosko, you're going to respond first. What's your plan to reduce property taxes?
Well, I don't know if anybody can look you in the eye tonight and say we can reduce property taxes, but I believe I'm the best, if you look at my history, the one who's been arguing for years about return on investment. When the city invests in things, let's get the greatest return possible. The more revenue you have coming into the city, the less need there is to tax or add fee increases to the people who live and own property here. It's going back to, it's critical that Macy's becomes a self-sustaining major attraction for downtown to pull in people. When people come here, they spend money. Sales taxes are part of that. And so that the number one way to reduce future property and tax increases, we got to get people coming here spending money. We got to get people here investing money, making downtown more attractive for businesses. That's the basics. Thank you.
Ms. Naker, reducing property taxes, possible, doable?
Sure, anything's possible. I'm an optimist. And I have to say, you know, one of the most exciting things about door knocking, one of them is that you're not phone banking, so you're not a telemarketer bothering people. You're actually getting to meet people. And one of the most exciting things about doing it this season has been that really so many of the people I've talked to, especially downtown, a lot of the younger people moving in or the people who've maybe left a house in the suburbs to move downtown, is there's this real optimism and excitement about where the city is going, except when it comes to taxes. And that's because we've seen our taxes go up every single year for the last decade. And it's especially a little bit of salt in the wound when you also see our services not keeping up with our taxes. So when you drive across Marshall and it hits Lake Street and suddenly the snow is plowed and removed. And I'm sorry, I keep making these references. I'm going to stop, I promise. But public services really need to be outstanding, especially if you're going to ask people to keep paying more. So to me, I think the way that you don't have to keep asking people for additional property taxes is to expand our tax base. The only kind of land use that actually brings in more revenue to the city than it takes in services is commercial industrial land. And we already have a very built-up city. A third of our land is not taxable because it's government or higher ed or nonprofit. So it's really important to me that whenever we have horizontal space, we're making it easy via the ways I mentioned before for commercial industrial to move in there and help expand our tax base. And then we put residential hopefully on top of that, a lot of mixed use development.
Thank you very much. Mr. Tobolt, reducing property taxes.
So for 17 years, I've worked for Ramsey County and I worked for a county commissioner. And when you get your property tax bill, it has the little Ramsey County logo on it. So I spent a lot of time thinking about property taxes and thinking about how this goes. So I'm going to try to keep it to 3. It's probably going to get to 4 things I'm going to do. But usually when I get to the end of this question at the door, I'm to 5 or 6 and another thing. But I'm going to start with first, we need to make sure that we work with other municipalities across the state to get the state to pay its fair share. There's a thing called local government aid. It is how the state offsets the taxes for cities, and it helps St. Paul, Minneapolis, as well as Virginia, and anywhere there's an urban center, because it's just a fair way to do it. It's something that started to be in vogue to cut under Pawlenty, and we lost a lot, and that happened over the course of this last 15 years, that people sort of use as that benchmark of why my taxes have gone up and services have gone down. So we need to make sure that we build that back up. Secondly, we need to look at ourselves and look at efficiencies and how we budget. And I think that we need to, like Bill said, get return on our investment and actually track that return on the investment. One of the things that we've done at Ramsey County is go to an outcome-based budget model so that we can actually put what we're looking to get when we spend those tax dollars, and then go back and say, did we get that out of that investment? And if we didn't, how do we get there? So we're actually getting we can track the return on the investment. We can also look at real efficiencies. There are things like the enterprise computer system and how Ramsey County pays its bills and everything, and how St. Paul pays its bills with the computer system, how the school board or the school district does its. And these systems cost like $12 million each, and we each buy our own. And the contracts come up around the same time. About 10 years ago, we had this opportunity to merge with St. Paul, between St. Paul and Ramsey County. It didn't happen. It's going to come up for an option soon, and I think we're going to, I of course, want to do that. Also, we need to grow the tax base, and economic development is one of those ways. The levy is a number. It's a real number, and the more people who are paying on that, then the less we all individually pay. So by having more taxpayers, we each pay less taxes. So it's important to look at our tax base. And it's also important to not to dial back the tax increment financing, like I had mentioned before. If we're going to get, we need to get the return on investment out of the downtown development that's happening. We need to dial back some of that tax increment financing, let some of these districts retire, and actually start using that money to decrease all of our property taxes.
Oh, that's good. And that's actually a perfect segue into this next question, which Rebecca Naker will start with. And I'm going to tweak it a little bit because the audience member wrote, how much should we use tax increment financing? How many people know what tax increment financing is? Be honest. Educated group. This is basically where you make a big investment in a piece of property, but the city wants you to make that investment, and so they let your future property taxes kind of go to pay down the money that you put into building that skyscraper or whatever. A lot of downtown St. Paul's in a tax increment district. So when, if ever, should we use that tool for economic development, Rebecca Naker?
So there's an old Hasidic tale about an old rabbi who used to walk around everywhere he went, and he'd carry two pieces of paper, one in each pocket. And the first said, "The entire world was created for me." And the other piece of paper said, "I am dust, and to dust I will return." I think in St. Paul, sometimes we have a little too much of the latter piece of paper in our pockets. The whole point of that story is that you're supposed to balance a feeling of value and self-affirmation and worth with a feeling of humility. I think in St. Paul right now, it's a new day. We're booming. We have so much investment going on. It is such an exciting time. We don't need to be making the kinds of giveaways that we've done in the past just to ensure that people come and develop here. Now, there may be a situation where a particular parcel is incredibly hard to develop, and we've seen cases like this on the Planning Commission, where it might make sense to give some public incentive for development. But in general, I don't think TIF financing is necessary anymore, and I'm particularly opposed when we do things like, with the MLS Stadium, forfeit property taxes forever on a parcel, because we believe that's the only way that we can attract somebody to our city. I think we're better than that now.
Mr. Tobel, you had some words about TIF. Should we ever use it, and if so, when?
Yes, it does play a role, and it's one of the. I'm not going to overuse the tool toolbox. I'm going to stop. But it is does play an important role oftentimes in development, and the important thing is that it doesn't get overused, and that we do let those districts retire. The problem is that some of those districts in the past, or in the recent past. When they've come to retire, have just been rolled over and then made into sort of these amoeba districts, sort of to pay for something else over here, to pay for something else over here. The other thing is, in some of the asks, they ask for the entire amount of new taxes be paid back to the bonds, where there's opportunities to, say, take some of the new tax revenue and put it in towards a smaller part of the financing. I think the time when it makes sense to use is a very difficult parcel, or if there's a great public benefit outside of just that building. When we're using it to enrich one particular developer, then it doesn't make as much sense. If we're looking at this is going to provide access to the river for everyone, you know, it's part of a building, but there's part of a private development, but it has a great public benefit, say, like river access or something like that.
Mr. Hosko, when, if ever, should we use tax increment financing to boost development?
On perhaps occasion. Earlier I mentioned the importance of the city issuing an annual report talking about the profits and the losses. And yes, there's a lot of development going on in and around downtown St. Paul. But the truth is, an awful lot of it's public money. There's not a lot of private investment going on down here. We're in downtown Minneapolis, with the exception of the stadium. It is seemingly the reverse. The West Publishing site, I'm still so sad that the county is spending $15 million to destroy that building and the jail. You know, looking back, the county should have never taken the property off the tax rolls when it took it from West Publishing. When you think of how many much property tax we've lost since that happened many years ago. One of the things I push with Rafael Ortega, county commissioner, is you're offering that building and the jail for free to a developer, but he did not want to offer any development money. I asked him again and again, you're prepared to spend up to $15 million to destroy them. Why won't you offer that money to a potential developer? He never answered the question. So that tells me he fully intended on destroying the buildings. So they're going to replace them with an 80-foot high, 3-block long concrete wall. It's going to be rather disturbing once it's all done and we take a look at it. That site will likely require TIF financing. They're destroying 700 and some thousand square feet. To replace that amount of commercial square footage today is about $200 a square foot. So that is one site where TIF financing will likely be needed.
All right, and we're getting almost the end of our debate. I did want to try to squeak in one last audience question or a version of an audience question because it's very newsy, it's very today. Black Lives Matter, St. Paul is planning to try to disrupt the Twin Cities Marathon. Mayor Coleman came out saying the police should keep all options on the table, including arresting people or whatever it takes to allow the marathon to go forward. What do you think should be done in that kind of push and pull between free speech and freedom to hold a marathon? Darren Tobold.
I'm confident that it'll work out. I'm confident that, I mean, there was a lot of great concern over what was going to happen around the protests in the state fair or the first Vikings game. But these things, the police, the Black Lives Matter organization, they were able to work it out in such a way that we were both able to read about the concerns and talk about it, but the day did go on.
Mr. Hosko?
I was just talking to a gentleman up on Summit Avenue about this. I ran the Twin Cities Marathon 4 times. I ran the first 2, skipped a year and ran 2, and I haven't done it since. I don't think the organization should disrupt the marathon. That's not the best way to get your message across. You know, life isn't fair. I don't believe the people who run this city and the police department are racist. You know, many of you know I'm a gay man. I've just turned 53. I've spent my entire adult life, you know, in the heart of the gay movement, and that was also during the heart of all the negative comments made about gay people by a lot of politicians, and I just think of all the hurt it caused. But never for a moment in all of these years did I ever allow myself to feel a victim because of that. It's like, if they have an issue with my being gay or other people being gay, that's their problem, it's not mine. And the people with the Black Lives Matter movement, you know, life's not fair. People have put hurdles up in front of me. They've said mean things to me as well. It never hurt my inner happiness or my inner spirit. And I would encourage them to think about that and perhaps direct their energies at a different event than the Twin Cities Marathon.
Ms. Naker?
I have to say I regret the mayor's choice of words. I think saying something like all options are on the table is a bit incendiary. Makes it sound like we're at war with our own citizens. I believe Black Lives Matter has the right to protest, and I believe that the athletes in the marathon have the right to run a safe marathon. And I put absolute faith, I think our police officers have shown themselves to be professional and to be able to handle the situation so that everybody has a safe outcome.
All right, well, that brings us to the end of the audience question portion of the debate. There's only one thing left to do, which is a closing statement from each of the candidates. Go about 2 minutes with these, give or take, And we will begin with Mr. Hosko.
I had to start this off. Don't I get the last word?
It's just a whoever was the next in line in the rotation of the audience questions. There was no more thinking to it than that.
That's fine. Oh, what do I say, folks? This is my pitch, huh? You know, I've been here a long time. I know this city well. I've loved this city. I've stayed here. I've just opened a second business, and it's losing money every day. I'll tell you the truth. It's losing money every single day. Music Forest Cafe. After the election's over, then I'll have time to market it. It'll do just fine. I can't tell you how much I love the city. That scrapbook collection. I'd love to show you all the books that I have. St. Paul is a special city. I think what makes it really unique is its geographic setting is just so remarkable, with the bend in the river. And they talk about St. Paul being a city of neighborhoods, and it's the geography that created that. You got all these valleys and these different areas. And I just absolutely adore that about St. Paul. And if you look at St. Paul architecturally, few cities can compare to have such a breadth of outstanding architecture. And what they were building, particularly a century ago, is just tremendous today to look at it. Minneapolis is more of a flat plain over there, you know, but St. Paul's has got that geographic history. I remember a reporter for the Tribune, Star Tribune, Linda Max, used to be the architecture reporter. She called herself a closet St. Paulite, even though she had a really nice house over on the Lake of the Isles in Minneapolis. And one of the things that she talked about is St. Paul, she said, there's a sense that the history still exists in St. Paul. And that's true, and I think that's one of the things that makes St. Paul so special. If you look at the art that I've done, I mean, who would spend their career drawing and painting St. Paul as I've done? And I just felt compelled to do it, no regrets. And I don't know, I'm having a good time campaigning, meeting people, lit dropping, getting a few lawn signs out. And I think I'm going to win this. And I hope with your help, we are going to go to City Hall come January. Thank you.
And next up is Rebecca Naker.
Thank you again to our hosts. Thank you all for coming here and sitting through this very important conversation. I've really enjoyed the discussion tonight, but I always find these forums to be a little bit artificial because we sit up here and we are expected to have all the answers and you have all the questions. And the truth is that the next city council member for Ward 2 is not going to be the person who has all the answers. If there's anything I've learned over the last 2 years of campaigning, it's that I actually have very, very few answers. The person who is successful in this seat is going to be the person who does two things: listens extremely well and works incredibly hard. Those are two things that I have been doing for my entire life, my entire career, and this entire campaign. In fact, if you want to know how much a cup of coffee costs at any coffee shop in this entire city, I can tell you, because I've been to all of them, having hundreds and hundreds of conversations. I look forward to continuing to do that all the way up until November 3rd and every day afterward. And I hope that I've managed to persuade you tonight that I can be a fresh, bold, independent voice for our ward, and I hope to earn your support. Thank you.
And final closing statement will come from Darren Tobolt.
Well, I too want to thank you for taking the time and sitting here and listening to us, and hopefully we answered your questions. I'm sure we'll all be hanging out afterwards trying to answer more of your questions. It's just been really exciting in this campaign. It's really exciting in this opportunity to have these conversations. And the things that we've talked about here today are things that I'm ready to start doing on day one. I love St. Paul. I especially love Ward 2. Like Bill said, I mean, the city of neighborhoods, I mean, Ward 2 is blessed with the four best neighborhoods in St. Paul. It's easy to be parochial. But these are the greatest neighborhoods. They're the oldest neighborhoods in St. Paul. I guess there's a little bit on the east side, but there's the oldest neighborhoods in St. Paul. It's downtown. It's really what's really vital about this city. So I want to make sure that you know that I'm here to work with you to build strong neighborhoods. I want to make sure that we're providing quality services and that we're an engaged community. I've been doing that here in St. Paul for 20 years, and I hope to be your first choice on November 3rd. Thank you, and everyone have a good night. I guess I'll toss it back to Curtis.
I got it. All right. Well, thank you to all the candidates. Give them all a round of applause. And thank you for submitting your questions, and then I'll hand it back to your organizers for a final word.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
I want a round of applause for Curtis. He did a great job. And again, thank you to the candidates. You all did very, very well. We're very excited to have you here today. And they will be outside at their tables or milling around for the next however minutes they want to stay, so you can have a chance to meet with them one-on-one. Again, thank you for coming, and have a great night, and drive safe on the way home.